Welcome to the Nano Entrepreneurship Network podcast, where entrepreneurs who have transitioned ideas into the marketplace share some of the lessons they've learned as they navigated the technology development pathway. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Today, I'm joined by Rui Jing Jiang, co-founder and CEO at Avisi Technologies. Rui Jing, thank you so much for joining us. To get us started, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got started in this company?
Sure, and thanks so much for having me. I'm so happy to have this opportunity to chat with you. So I started Avisi Technologies when I was a junior at the University of Pennsylvania, studying finance, strategic management, and economics at Wharton. At the time, I was really unsure what I wanted to do with my career. I come from a very medical family. For a long time, I thought perhaps I would go down that path. And I had done internships in pharmaceutical companies and large bulge bracket banks. I had a lot of options in front of me. And that year in school, there was a very interesting opportunity called the Y Prize. And the Y Prize is a competition that the University of Pennsylvania developed to encourage students across all disciplines to apply their learning and help commercialize a pre-existing technology invented at school, at the university. And that year, there was a very novel material that had been invented by Professor Igor Bargatin in the School of Mechanical Engineering. And it was a very thin nanotechnology that was at the same time very robust and flexible. We looked at that technology, my co-founders and I, and we thought, wow, this is very interesting. Wouldn't it be cool if we could take this ultra-thin material and use it to impact human health? Are there small implants in the body that can benefit from being even smaller? That really led us down the path of ophthalmology, where vision is such an integral part of how we experience our lives and our world. And the organ is very small and very isolated from the rest of the body. A lot of the interventions that happen in the eye to preserve our vision are all micro scale or even smaller than that. And so we really saw an opportunity here to make an impact with this technology, ended up deciding on using it to impact glaucoma, which is the world's leading cause of irreversible blindness. Glaucoma affects over 80 million people worldwide, over close to 4 million people in the US, and it's an irreversible disease. So a lot of the implants that are used in glaucoma today continue to have shortcomings because of their form factor, their size, or their materials. And we thought this nanotechnology could really make an impact. So fast forward, we decided to enter this Y Prize competition, ended up winning a $10,000 prize at the end, which we invested into a very small animal study just to see if, you know, the material had interesting properties in vivo. That turned out to be pretty compelling, so we decided to form a small company. We involved all of Penn's resources for entrepreneurs. I feel so lucky to have gone there, including the legal clinic and entrepreneurship clinics. Started gaining more momentum. We participated in a variety of incubators, including VentureWell, which is a university tech transfer-focused accelerator, as well as a couple others, you know, through the Singh Center for Nanotechnology. They actually supported us with a small seed grant. And that culminated in another grant that we applied for called the President's Innovation Prize. And this is unique to the University of Pennsylvania. It's essentially a $100,000 project fund for the company, plus a $50,000 living stipend. And it's given out to graduating seniors who want to start a venture. And so that was really fantastic. President Amy Gutman of the University of Pennsylvania supporting us in that way. Got us enough momentum and data to apply for the National Science Foundation's SBIR program. And we went through phase one. We just won phase two and are working our way through that. And we're about to start more clinical trial work. So we've really come a long way from 2017 until now. And we definitely have a lot of gratitude for the Singh Center and programs like that for allowing us to do this.
That's very exciting. And you wrapped up a lot of things about the ecosystem that has supported you in this endeavor. And I want to go back and explore several of the things that you've mentioned. But before I do that, can you talk a little bit more about the material itself? Is it a polymer? And how is it made? Can you share information about that?
We are working with a ceramic that is coated in a biocompatible polymer. Our device is only 5 microns in thickness, but the nanotechnology part of it is the core, the ceramic core that enables our very thin film-like material to have robust mechanical properties. For example, it has 1,000 times the stiffness of a planar film. It's flexible and shape recovering. It can withstand deformations, allowing it to be suitable for minimally invasive surgeries. And it's very conformal. So when we put it in the eye, it can conform to the globe nicely and really sit where it's supposed to sit. Now, to tell you a little bit more about how it relates to glaucoma, the disease that we're treating, I think it's important to step back and understand how this disease actually works. So in normal eyes, we're always constantly producing and cycling a fluid called aqueous humor. And this fluid is what nourishes your eye tissue. But in eyes with glaucoma, the drainage system is blocked. That leads to this fluid building up inside the eye, leading to high pressures on the optic nerve. And that's what damages the nerve and leads to progressive blindness. Now, glaucoma is very asymptomatic. A lot of patients end up not even realizing that their vision is tunneling in. And the CDC estimates that only 50% of all patients are even diagnosed. So for all the listeners out there, it's really important to get a full eye exam, especially as you enter, you know, your 40s and your 50s. Now, a lot of the interventions that center around treating glaucoma are trying to either increase the outflow of this pent-up fluid or reduce the production. And we're in the increase outflow category. So our device, it is a microfluidic device that has many, many channels. We insert it into the eye to help create a secondary pathway for all that pent-up fluid. It drains to a small pocket inside your eye between the clear layer of tissue, the conjunctiva, and the white layer, the sclera. And from there, our device is able to become a reservoir for that fluid, allowing it to be reabsorbed into the surrounding tissues to lower pressure within the eye and protect the optic nerve. So our device is called Visiplate. And when we approached the conception of this, we started identifying the issues with the current technologies and thinking about where this ultra-thin, flexible, multi-channel material can come into play.
Great. Thank you so much for explaining both the disease and how your device is addressing some of the issues surrounding that. I want to go back to some of the earlier comments you made. You mentioned the Y Prize. You mentioned engaging in venture well, receiving some funds to get started. And then you also mentioned the Singh Center. And the Singh Center is one of the NSF-funded National Nanotechnology Coordinated Infrastructure Sites, which provides access to instrumentation for researchers and small businesses like yourself. So can you share the type of engagement you've had with the Singh Center and what that enabled you to do?
Absolutely. The Singh Center has been a fantastic resource for the company and just a great partner. The initial technology that was invented by the professor was conceived in the Singh Center. After that technology was patented and then opened up to the university for this commercialization competition, we got more involved with prototyping there and creating, you know, initial concepts after we had left the university. So we have been regular users of the facility for the last couple of years now. When we won our SBIR grants, you know, they were a huge portion of the project because we needed facilities to prototype and to test and to examine all of our devices. And even today, even as we're, you know, working with outside manufacturers, we still like to come back to Singh and use it as our rapid prototyping facility. The staff there is amazing. The machinery is awesome. And yes, I just think it's such a unique environment that we're very lucky to have access to.
So you mentioned funding from NSF and receiving a phase one and more recently a phase two SBIR awards. Can you share a little bit about your experience with that process?
We're huge fans of the SBIR program. They gave us non-dilutive funding when we were very early on, when we just had very small proof of concept and, you know, a lot of big dreams. So the National Science Foundation and the Medical Devices Group have really been instrumental in our progress. Winning the SBIRs also helped us gain more investor buy-in. It was a very rigorous diligence process, as I think many people are familiar with. And that helps give investors confidence that what we're doing, you know, has true scientific intellectual merit, is truly defensible, and will have a big impact.
So you've been in a fairly supportive environment and being part of the UPenn ecosystem. provided you opportunities. You mentioned Singh Center. I think there's a Ben Franklin that's in that region. Can you maybe share some good advice that you received when you were first starting out?
The best advice we received was actually through the VentureWell program. For context, VentureWell is an incubator nationally run that focuses on university spin-out technologies, right? Oftentimes in school, whether you're a student or a professor, you're just thinking about your technology and the product and the big problem you're trying to solve, and you're not really thinking too much about your customer just yet. But what VentureWell forces you to do is talk to those customers very early on. And talk to them in a way that's very open and not leading, so they can tell you what they really need. I think that emphasis on talking to customers, interviewing them with an open mind, really helps with product development and market characterization and understanding that this is the way you should build your product in order to have a product market fit. Even though I studied economics and business, in a sense, that's not really emphasized until much later on. So I thought that program was fantastic. I think all entrepreneurs should really try to understand the product market fit by interviewing customers early on, because you will avoid so many pitfalls that way.
Speaking of pitfalls, as you look back, have there been decisions that you've made along the way that you wish you had done differently?
I don't think that I would have done things differently, because every challenge became such a big learning opportunity that ended up taking us to where we are today. So if I had changed anything, the company might not be where we are today, which is in a pretty good place, making a lot of R&D progress and really on track to meet our goals. So I don't think that as an entrepreneur, you have the luxury of regretting your decisions. You really have to think about each experience as, what can I learn from this and how can I apply it to making a, you know, more impactful decision in the future?
So you mentioned that your background is in economics. Can you discuss the makeup of your team and the role of interdisciplinarity?
My co-founder studied material science engineering and has a minor in chemistry. So we were perfectly complementary to each other in skill set. And then we brought on a fabulous vice president of R&D, Georgia. And Georgia's background is in math, physics, and nanotechnology. So with each person we brought into the organization, we really try to look for their unique skills and how it adds to the organization. We are very lucky to have a very expert medical advisory board. These are physicians who have run organizations like the American Glaucoma Society. They have very robust practices. Their breadth of clinical experience is something that the core team didn't have initially. So we're able to go to them and really pick their brains about how the disease works and how we should think about how our intervention is going to treat the disease. And then, of course, we also have business and strategic advisors who've run huge organizations. So between everyone, we definitely have a very diverse mix of expertise and thought leadership. So I think team is everything. As an entrepreneur, you need to understand that you don't know everything, and it's okay to ask for help. In fact, you should involve other people and get their advice and get their buy-in and get their help.
So you mentioned that the technology grew out of research at UPenn. Can you talk a little bit about your IP strategy?
When we first started out, we didn't really understand what IP strategy even was. We thought, hey, this is a cool technology. It was already patented. Let's just license it. Well, it's not that simple. Negotiating a license can be quite complicated, especially when the university sees it as a major part of their revenue stream. So for us, we really had to educate ourselves quickly on what are market standard royalty fees, for example, for once you commercialize your device, you're all successful, how much are you going to pay back to the university? You have to think about things like historic patent costs. You have to think about whether or not you want to give up a little bit of your company in order to lower other fees that the university might want to levy upon you in order to allow you to exercise this patent. And that makes sense from their perspective too, right? They invested so much in the professor and in the IP and all of that. So once we were able to go through this negotiation process and become more educated, we started thinking more about what are other areas in this medical device development process that we also want to protect. For example, not just the core technology, but the way we're using it, the designs we're using, for example, the diseases we're treating. And we started building out patents in those areas. And then we filed those patents abroad as well. You always want to think about the major markets you'll want to target in the future and get those protections out early.
That's great. And I just want to thank you for taking the time to talk with us and share your excitement about this entrepreneurial adventure that you're on. It sounds very exciting and really important. So we wish you a great deal of luck in your endeavors. But before we leave, do you have any advice that you would give to young entrepreneurs that are just starting out?
Stay resilient. Entrepreneurship is not a very easy path, but it certainly is the most exciting. And even when you face challenges or you don't know what to do, just know that there are other people just like you who've gone through it, who are out there, and you can reach out to them and ask for help and for advice. And yeah, don't hesitate to reach out. We're all here. We're happy to help each other. And it's a really, really fun time. So highly encourage you all to try it once at least. And yeah, stay resilient. You'll get through, you know, whatever challenges, and don't be afraid.
Well, thank you for sharing some of the lessons that you have learned. And thanks to you who've listened in today. If you're interested in joining the Nanotechnology Entrepreneurship Network, please go to nano.gov/nanoentrepreneurshipnetwork or email nen@nnco.nano.gov.